Oh, hello there. Caught me just polishing the old heat pump. What was that? You'd like to see my heat pump installation? Okay, go on then. Let me show you around. So a bit of context for this video is needed, really. NESTA, which is a charitable foundation that was set up to support innovation, run a scheme called Visit a Heat Pump, where people can sign up to go and visit someone's home and take a guided tour of their heat pump setup. Heat pump owners can also register as a host for one of these tours. I'll be honest here, I don't really want you guys walking around my home, judging my paintwork and writing messages in the dirt on my windows. So I've decided to put together this virtual tour for you. So let's pretend you're really here, only I won't be able to see you yawning while I'm talking. The best place to start then is outside, and this is the heat pump. It's a 6 kilowatt Daikin unit which was installed by Octopus Energy in December 2023. So yes, it was cold while it was being done, so it's probably sensible to have your installation done in the summer if you can, but I imagine the installers are less busy in the winter. 6 kilowatts doesn't mean that it pulls 6 kilowatts of power. That's how much heat power it can output. So let's say it was outputting 6 kilowatts of heat and it was running at a COP of 4. That means it was only using 1.5 kilowatts of electrical power. I'm assuming you know all about COP, or coefficient of performance, if you're looking at heat pumps. The whole reason that they're one of the most efficient ways of heating your home. You're not creating heat directly from the energy that you put in, you're farming the heat from the air outside and compressing it and transferring it into water that heats your home, and moving energy around takes less energy than converting electrical energy directly into heat. There's no getting away from the fact that a heat pump is quite large and it does take up a big chunk of space in your garden. You've got this large fan here for pulling in the air over the large heat exchanger that's sitting around the back behind it. This is what's known as a monoblock heat pump, meaning that it's basically just one unit. The water that runs around your heating system is plumbed straight into the back of the monoblock. There's a pump inside which pulls the water in, it gets heated, and then off it goes back into your house. The alternative is a split unit. Those have an external component still, a bit like this, but also an internal unit. Your water circuit runs to the indoor unit, and then that's connected to the outdoor unit by pipes containing just the refrigerant. This method can offer you a bit more flexibility, but requires more specialist work for running those refrigerant lines. When the heat pump is in operation, you end up with a lot of condensation on the heat exchanger. This needs to drain away somewhere, so you can see that this heat pump is sitting on a gravel bed. This is a soakaway and it stops the condensation puddling on the ground. In winter that could get quite dangerous if it froze and someone walked on it. You can also install a drain kit which catches the water and it can be plumbed straight into a drain. That way you don't need a soakaway. The heat pump can then just sit on a level base and take up less room. On the wall here we have a mini consumer unit. This gets its power from inside my garage. I'll show you that in a bit. We have switches for the heat pump itself and also the immersion heater that's in the hot water tank. That water tank is in the garage, but because the immersion, or booster heater as it's called here, is controlled by the heat pump, the isolation switch is outside. I've also put in a sneaky little Shelly energy monitor in here so as I can keep an eye on how much energy this whole thing is using. If you're wondering how noisy it is, well, it isn't silent. It can be a bit noisy when it first starts up, but most of the time it doesn't run at full power because it just doesn't need to. I've made another video where I did a noise test, so I'll put a link to that in the description for you if you want to check that out. I also go over running costs and things like that. You may have noticed these large black pipes running along my wall. Well, these are the flow and return pipes for the heating system. The old boiler was in the garage and that's where the pipes ran to originally, and they've been extended to run outside and to the heat pump. They actually run inside these fascias here. I'll overlay some footage from when I first installed it so as you can see that. Because they're external, they are heavily insulated. The insulation's about an inch thick. The insulation is very important, of course, because you don't want these pipes freezing in winter, and you don't want to lose the heat in these pipes to the outside world. You need as much of that heat as possible, making it inside your house and to your radiators. We had planned to put the heat pump here, but due to planning regulations, we had to move it further away from our neighbours. There was an option of running those pipes under the slabs right here, and that would have made it a lot neater, but I would have had to have dug that trench myself, and I'll be honest, I couldn't be bothered with that, but it is an option if you needed to have your heat pump located away from your property. Anyway, let's follow these pipes inside the garage. I'm going to show you the electrics first because all of this has to be powered from somewhere. I've got a give energy gateway, but that's essentially where my power comes in. My power supply comes out of the gateway and runs up to a consumer unit that's just on the other side of this wall in the house. The electrician has split the supply here with these Henley blocks, and that runs to a new consumer unit just here. There's a 40 amp supply in here, which you can see, and that comes out of the top and runs all the way across the garage outside to that other mini consumer unit that I showed you before. And if you're moving from gas heating, then you should make sure you also move to a smart electricity tariff, so as you can make use of cheaper off-peak energy rates, which will help keep your running costs down. There are many suppliers and tariffs to pick from. I'm with Octopus Energy, and they have a Cozy Octopus tariff for heat pump owners, or Octopus Go if you've got an EV, which is the tariff that I'm on. And that one is very useful if you've also got batteries. If you do decide to switch to Octopus, then please consider using my referral code, which is right here, and we'll both get £50 of credit once your switch is completed. Now, this is what the installers called the plant room. I just call it the back of my garage. Obviously, the biggest component here is the water tank. This is a 250 litre tank. Now, my old tank was 160 litres and in the airing cupboard upstairs. I'll show you that in a bit because MCS regulations said we needed a 250 litre tank for this four-bedroom house. The tank is too big to fit in the old cupboard, which is only half height anyway, and above the stairs. Keep in mind that you need more hot water capacity with a heat pump than you did with your boiler. You tend to store it at a lower temperature, so 50 degrees instead of 60 degrees, and that means you need a higher hot water to cold water ratio for showers and baths. Keep that in mind. You can't think, oh, 160 litres was fine before, I only need that much with my heat pump. No, you'll need a lot more, I promise. So lots and lots of pipes here. I'm sure this could have been done on a smaller scale, but they've spread it out nicely because they could. We have an expansion vessel up the top because my heating system had to be converted from a gravity fed to a sealed system. And there's also another tank above the hot water tank, which I was told acts as a volumizer and a buffer. I think this is needed because I have 10 millimeter microbore pipes running to my radiators, and that reduces the overall volume of water in the system. This tank here increases that volume, which helps improve the efficiency. If I've got that wrong and have misunderstood, then sorry, just complain about me in the comments. I'm not a heating engineer. Anyway, there's obviously the main control screen here as well. This is also called the MMI and is where you set all of your schedules for heating and hot water. The commissioning is done from here too, and this is the device that connects to your Wi-Fi network for remote control from your phone. There is a little card stuck in the side of it that's actually the Wi-Fi adapter. I've had to put a Wi-Fi mesh node in the garage to make sure that it had a decent signal. That mesh node actually supports a few things in the garage, but it also made the connection to the heating system a lot more reliable too. Over here is a little dial that tells me the pressure inside the system. I've been told to keep an eye on that and check it every couple of weeks to make sure it's on 1.5. I have had to open this valve here to increase the pressure a couple of times since it was installed. The old boiler was on the wall just there, and they filled in the hole using expanding foam and a vent cover. I know some people saw my other videos and thought that this was a terrible way of doing it, but honestly, I'm not bothered, it does the job. There were a couple of new holes that needed to be drilled in my wall in order to get the pipes out to the heat pump, and you can see them up there. And also there was another smaller low down one for like an emergency pressure release drain. They've joined the new system to the existing radiator circuits in the rafters of this garage and added some isolation valves up there too, and run some new pipes to connect to the cold water supply and hot water by extending those from the sink in my utility room, which was very conveniently right next to the garage. Of course, the gas supply was no longer needed, so they capped that pipe down as low as they could near to where it came in. Now, if this was the only gas appliance I had, then I could have had the meter totally removed, but I've still got a gas hob in the kitchen and I need to get some new wiring put in before I can replace that with an electric one, and then I can fully get rid of my gas supply. Oh yeah, and there is one final thing in the garage. There's a wire running from around here somewhere all the way up along the roof line and around there to a little mystery box that's on the wall. I've no idea what is in there. I haven't powered down the system to take a look. So if any of my installers happen to watch this, then please let me know what the hell that is. So I'm inside the house now, and this is the thermostat. Well, technically I guess it's not a thermostat, it's just a temperature sensor and controller. It is hardwired to the MMI in the garage. I don't think that they had a wireless option, but luckily there was a wired thermostat here before and we could reuse the cables. Controls on here are very basic. You can turn it on and off, change the set point temperature for the heating, and boost the hot water if you want to. There is no scheduling on this one, and you have to go to the MMI or use the app on your phone for that. So I have 14 radiators in my house. They changed 9 of them because they either weren't quite large enough or in a couple of cases were rusting really badly. The ones that were upgraded tend to be roughly the same physical length and height, but they'd put in ones with fins on the back or double panelled ones. This one here in my lounge didn't need upgrading. It was already a K2, which is a double panelled one, with fins inside it. You can see the pipes are very narrow, only 10mm copper pipes, and this is the smallest bore pipes that Octopus would install a system on when I had mine done. I'm not sure if that's changed at all. With a heat pump, you ideally want the largest bore possible, so as you can get a higher flow rate through it. I'm going to lose some efficiency because of these pipes, but it's a trade-off between having the most efficient system possible and having a still reasonably efficient system, but not needing to smash my house apart to replace pipes. And here's one of the new radiators that they installed. This is in my study and it's a nice white modern looking radiator. They have fitted TRVs to all of the radiators and I was told that was because it was an MCS requirement. But it's important to leave those fully open, especially downstairs, because you don't want to start restricting part of the system as it'll affect the performance of the whole thing. Well, we're now upstairs and this is the old airing cupboard. It's where the hot water tank used to live and it's now just a storage area for towels and things. They had to do some plumbing wizardry in here to loop the heating and hot water circuits back around on themselves, and I had to change my shower over because it was pumped before and now it uses mains water pressure, so the control unit for that is up there. Anyway, thank you ever so much for visiting. If you're thinking about using Octopus Energy for your heat pump installation, then make sure you give them my reference number when you get your quote, and I'll put that on the screen now for you. They'll give you a £100 discount and I'll get £100 of credit too once your installation has been completed. Please give this video a like and don't forget to subscribe for free to see more from me. Thank you for watching. Goodbye.